This is the last, potentially the last great rail deal for a generation. So I'm interested to know, other than scale, what does it get you?
You know, number one, let me thank you for having me this morning, giving me the opportunity to talk about this transformational deal. This deal is so unique in the benefits. Pro-service, pro-competition, pro for the North American economy. The timing is ideal. In fact, it's a perfect time. The stars have aligned to create a deal like this. Often that's what it requires. You've got two like-minded CEOs bringing two very strong companies together. In fact, we've led the industry from a CAGR basis in growth as well as earnings growth, revenue and earnings for the last 3 years. So with a common vision, a common operating philosophy, creating a network that can become the true backbone, connecting three countries on the heels of the USMCA agreement that enables commerce between the three companies at a time that the trade has never been more important, is compelling. The benefits are compelling.
Keith, your late mentor, Hunter Harrison, obviously was a huge part of this current zeal we have for precision scheduled railroading, making everything much more efficient. As I understand it, Kansas is already sort of on board with all of that. So I'm interested what you can do to drive the synergy numbers that you're talking about. I think $780 million is the annual run rate of synergies after a few years post-completion. And how do you get there?
Well, precision scheduled railroading is all about optimizing processes that end up allowing you to deliver superior service, a scheduled service at a low cost that has value in the marketplace. So to be able to take a network and expand the network and eliminate handoffs and eliminate inefficiencies, that's the natural outcome of running a railway more efficiently. Less handoffs, more fluidity, asset turns. You know, the $780 million of synergies, the beauty of that, although there are meaningful material synergies tied to cost, about $200 million order magnitude. The largest opportunity here is driven by growth. Those synergies that you spoke to, $600 million of that are growth synergies because it unlocks so much potential, extended reach for our customers at Canadian Pacific, for KCS's customers, connecting the two customers together so they can reach further, getting to new markets. They can grow and uniquely will grow with them, enabling that growth. That's what allows those synergies and why we feel so convicted. This very unique and new combination unlocks that beyond doubt.
Keith, let's talk quickly about the regulatory aspect of this. Obviously, something all investors in the railroad space are very focused on. Last time you did this dance with Norfolk Southern, obviously you and Hunter Harrison at Canadian Pacific trying to acquire them back in 2015, 2016, the STB were told by the Department of Justice, look, don't let this trust be formed. It doesn't make sense. It effectively allows Canadian Pacific to take control of a rival before the deal's been approved. What gives you the confidence that you seem to have that the trust will be approved this time around?
Because we're convicted in the story. It's a compelling value creation story. It's pro-service. It's pro-competition. It's pro for our employee base. It's pro-growth. It's pro for the North American economy. Those are fundamental differences that are undeniable.
But all of those things, if I may, Keith, all of those things were cited as reasons to do the Norfolk Southern deal as well. So I guess the question is, look, if the STB looks at the model of this trust, why are they going to change the way they approach it versus last time?
I'm convicted they're going to see the same truth, the same undeniable facts, that formula actually is the end result. That's what this produces. I'm confident when they look at the facts and we educate and answer their questions and they sort through their diligence on this deal, they're going to come to the same conclusion. I'm convicted of that.
And you talked about potentially having the deal approved, as in all out approved, in the middle of 2022. How quickly do you expect to have visibility on the trust and on, indeed, whether you're allowed to form it?
Well, as it is now, we're under the old rules prior to the changes in 2001, which is the way we're approaching this deal. We're going to submit paperwork, actually today, preliminary paperwork. We welcome people to take a look at the facts that they'll indicate. We expect to transition to trust in about a 4 to 6 month period. And then beyond that, 10 to 12 month period for the STB to review the facts to lead to what we expect is going to be a positive outcome mid-2022, where we'll start to combine, take control, and start to realize these synergies that we spoke so highly about.
And again, when I think about Hunter Harrison, he tried to do the Norfolk Southern deal, obviously tried to do CSX too. He didn't seem to like KSU as an asset, so I'm interested what you're seeing today that perhaps he didn't see back then.
The world has evolved. You know, listen, Hunter, I know him well. He's all about value creation. Where he's sitting here today and looking at the opportunities and the way the world has evolved, the nearshoring that's occurring, the growth that's occurred, Mexico to U.S., the way to connect that Canada, U.S., Mexico in a very unique time. This is a historic time in North America. The game's changed. The facts have changed. I'm convicted that if Hunter were with us today, he'd be making the same decision. There's no doubt in my mind that he fully would support what we're doing here.
And look, obviously, a lot of the railroad's recent success has come because we've seen such a slowdown in air freight during the pandemic. I wonder how much the industry can hold on to some of those gains it's made during the last year or 18 months.
I think there's a tremendous amount of opportunity to do that. There's a lot of pent-up demand. There's still part of the economy, obviously, that hasn't rebounded completely. There's still a wave of traffic trying to restock shelves, carrying momentum. And as we go forward, the other differentiator that we all talk about that's becoming more topical and critically important is the environment. If you look at the fundamentals of this deal, the ability for this deal to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in and of itself, taking trucks off congested highways, putting them on the rail and creating that dependable supply chain that allows that outcome, that in and of itself is wind at our back. It's a tailwind that this industry represents in value creation for the environment that's unlike any other mode of transportation.